بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والصلاة والسلام على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. Okay, so this is the second lecture about classes and objects. I will make a quick reminder of what we did yesterday. So our problem was to write a program that defines two students and then print their information. Okay, at first we have built the program using just the basic knowledge of CS101 of making a main function and then creating independent variables that have some names, okay, but they are independent, okay, and finally we have printed out this information related to these two students. And we realized that this way is not very efficient to build a good program. It's not flexible, it's a long code, it's very difficult to manage, and variables are not related. So the way that we did it is that we created a class, because here we observed that these two students have several things in common. They have several attributes in common, like first name, last name, phone. So we created the structure, okay, that is called the class, that represents a model of the student. So this class contains the attributes, okay, that we have defined as first name, last name, phone, GPA and address, okay? And then this allowed us to create the students in the test program. So to create the students, in the first time we have used the new students with an empty constructor and these initializers to default values, because Java provides a constructor for any class if you don't create it. And then we have improved our code. So we make the initialization at the creation time. And this was through a constructor that we have built ourselves. It has 5 arguments, and every argument is used to initialize one of the attributes. And then in our test program, we have created the students with initial values from the constructor. And then we noticed that the old constructor doesn't work because it was created by Java, so we had to create it ourselves again, a default constructor with no argument. Okay, and finally here, we printed the values. Okay, we can assign the values manually. Okay, this is before making the argument constructor. And then with the argument constructor, the initialization is just made at the creation time. And you can see that our code become very small, only 4 lines of codes to do the same thing as we did here. Okay, so this was the advantage of using an object-oriented programming paradigm as compared to structural or functional programming. So finally, we have created an array list of students to show that we can store student objects or any kind of objects into the array list. And then we use the for loop in order to print the different elements that are stored in the array lists. So this was what we did last time. Yes?
There is nothing in common between two students. We can't do it like that. Right?
If you have two different things, you have to create 2 different classes. So, okay? So an entity, it represents something common to several other objects. Okay? That's fine. So as you can see here now, if I go to my test program, I don't need this anymore. So I'm able actually to, if I want to change the values assigned here, okay, it's possible. So here I assigned Muhammad Ali, and here I would like to assign something different. I can also change the mobile phone number. I can put a phone. And I can also print, for example, first name ST1, okay, 2 dot here, and then what I should do, student1 dot first name. So that was possible. Which change? There is no change. Ah, yeah, it only happens for student one, not for student two. So this affects only this object, okay, because we assigned a value, a new value to the first name of student one object, not student two. Student two will not be affected because every object has its own attributes. They are not shared with the others. Okay, it's not shared. Okay, now let's look at these attributes, how they are defined. So by default, if we don't specify anything, all the attributes are considered as public. Okay, public, it means they are visible to the outside. And that is why we were able here to have access to these attributes. But in software engineering of object-oriented programming, in object-oriented programming, it is common and recommended, yet necessary, to define all attributes as private. Okay, so now I need to write private string first name. Okay, I know that you're asking yourself why. Okay, especially now we are going to discover that there are a lot of mess going after making private. So let me make private these two attributes. I will explain why, but let's see what happens first. Now if I come back to my program, what do you observe?
No first name.
Now there is a compilation error. It was not the case before. Why it was not the case? Sorry? Yeah, because it was public and now we made it private. Private is something private, khas. Okay? Someone has a private home, he does not allow others to access to his home. So the class has private attribute, it does not allow others, that is this client program, to access its attributes. That's very simple. Okay, it has the meaning of private, really. Okay, so you can see that now for the phone, it's still working fine. Okay, but if I change it here to private, we're going to have the same problem. And I cannot even access for writing values, nor access for reading values. Both are closed, in read mode or in write mode. I cannot do this. So why we bother ourselves with private?
So we don't change the information by mistake inside the method?
That's one of the reasons, yes. But there is a general reason now, object-oriented programming, yes. How security? For how? Okay. Huh? What's the security problem? Okay, it's something like this, yes. So we don't want the others to have access to our attributes in the way that they want, but in the way that the developer wants. Okay, there are several reasons. Let me now okay, let's try to put back this to public phone. And now I'm going to write this phone number. Is it a phone number?
No.
Is there anyone that can prevent me to write this?
No.
No. I have full access. I can write whatever I want. And this is going to compromise the program. Sahula. Okay, I don't want this to happen. Now, as a developer, okay, I have some attributes, but I want that the user uses the attribute in the correct way, in a valid way. So I would like to make kind of law enforcement. I would like to enforce only valid access to my variables. So how we can solve this? So let me put this public again here. Yeah. Now it's clear. In order to prevent this, I have to put this to private, and this kind of assignment will no longer be possible at the client program side. But now the question, okay, how if I want to change the value or if I want to read the value? Okay. So the idea here, since I cannot have access to the attribute, I must provide interfaces to this attribute. And the interface is just a public method in this case. There are two types of methods that we have to define for each private attribute. One method to read the attribute, because sometimes I need to read the value, and one method that modifies the attribute if I want to change the value somehow. And we are going to see why it's important to define a method for modifying, how I can restrict the or I can validate the input of the user. So by convention, when you write a method to read an attribute, it must start by get and then the name of the attribute. I would like to change, I would like to read the attribute phone. It must be get phone. I would like to read the attribute first name. It must be get first name. This is a convention, but it's important and necessary to stick with it. If I want to get the information of the last name or the value of the last name, get last name. This is for reading. For writing, it's the same. So it's not get now, it's set. I must do set and then the name of the attribute, set phone, set first name, and set last name. I'm going to apply these rules now, at least for the phone, because I have developed, I have put the phone as private. So just after the constructor, okay, we can actually do public. Now I would like to read the phone value. What is the type?
String.
Yeah, because the phone is string, so I'm going to return a string, and here get, and then the name of the attribute, phone, and then return phone. So this method is going to return. Look now, inside the class, I have access to the attribute. Outside the class, I don't have access to the attribute. So now, if I want to do something like phone of student one, it must be, okay, look, student one dot, look now, I have address, I have first name, I have last name, I have GPA. Do I have phone attribute?
No,
because it's the only one that is private. But I have the method get phone that will return me what? The phone value. So now I can very simply do things like this. Okay? So now I restricted the access to the phone, but I give the user a way on how to read the value. The second part is to modify. So this is reading the phone attribute. Now, modifying the phone attribute. Public. What does it return? It will not return anything because I'm going to modify. I'm not going to return, not going to read. So you return something when you read. I'm not going to read now. So I'm going to put void set phone. And here I have to put the value I would like to assign. So it's a string ph, for example. And then I'm going to write phone equal ph. So the phone attribute that I have hidden, I'm going to assign it to the parameter that I will give to the user. So now instead of writing this, I will be able to write student1 dot okay, it's hidden here. Now I have a method that is called set phone, and here I can put the value of the phone that I would like to set. Does this prevent the bad value to be assigned? No. How to solve this? Yes. We need to do what we call a validation inside the set method. So one of the purposes of using a set method to modify is that we can enforce the values that can be assigned to an attribute. How we can enforce using if statement. Now, for example, for a phone number to be valid, it must start with 05. And also the length must be equal to 10. So I can check this Sorry? Okay, now if you want to make a validation, what is your input that you would like to have, and you validate. Now for me, my code will just accept 0.5, no country code. If I want to make a country code, I have to change the data validation, okay? Maybe I would like to impose to have a plus or something like 0.0, so my data validation will be more complicated. But let's go for the simple case, okay? My code must start my phone if PH, so this attribute, okay, start with 0.5 and PH dot length
equals
10. Then I will make the assignment. Else, I can throw an exception, throw illegal argument exception. So there is an exception defined in Java that is called illegal argument exception. And here I will throw an error message, okay? Phone number is not valid. I can make system.out.println, it's possible, but throwing an exception is good, so I will force the program to stop. Okay, it's possible to have both of them, and here I have illegal argument new illegal argument exception. Look now.
I have to import this.
Yeah. So if I don't do the validation now, since I did the validation, I will execute illegal argument exception, phone number is not valid. One moment, please. Now, yeah, since I have, because now I have used set phone. Since I know set phone, it can throw an exception, I can make a try catch if I want. Catch what? Catch illegal argument exception E. Okay, I will make an S out. Check your phone number. The program will exit. Okay, and then I can make return to exit the program. Okay, if I execute again, check your phone number. This is to avoid this red message, error message. Okay, I can make a try catch in order to process the exception and write a proper error message at the end.
This validation is not enough, right?
No, the validation now, yeah. I mean, we can also add in the validation. We have to make sure that all are digits. I can put 10 characters, but they are not digit. Okay? And there are ways. You can look at character class. It has is digit method that can check. But now I'm going just to use only this validation. Okay, so now if I put a correct one, 0.5, 0.1, 0.2, 0.3, 0.4, so it starts with 0.5, it has 10 digits. So in principle, I should not have an exception. And you can see now, it has changed the phone. Okay, if I put even another value here, 99 at the end. Okay, in principle, I should find the value that I have assigned. Okay, so to summarize now, we created a get method to read, and we created a set method to write, and in the set method, we do what we call data validation. Okay. It seems to work fine. Okay, so you are observing now how our code is improving. And I remind again that here in CS102, our objective is not only to build programs, but is to build professional programs according to standards in software engineering. Okay?
So we can do this with the GBA, because the GBA must be out of 4 and 5.
Yeah. We have now, as I mentioned, All the attributes must be defined as private. And all private attributes must have get and set methods. Okay? So private here. Private here. I'm going to make it double. So now I am in the safe side. Others cannot use my class only in the way that I will restrict them to use it. Now if I want to change the validation here one day, it's possible. I will enforce, for example, to add the country code. It's possible.
So the purpose of making private is to not make others change anything.
Yes, it's to enforce the validation of data. This is one of the purposes. And this is a good software engineering practice that must be followed, okay? Usually when we define your attributes, you have to define them as private. Yes, I will come to you.
What's the purpose of get phone if I cannot do anything for?
Sorry?
For the reading. I can read it without private.
What's the purpose of get? So get is to read the value now.
From private, right?
Yes, look now. If I want to read the value, student1.getPhone. You want to remove the get? No problem. We remove the get. Okay, so we don't have get. How you can read this value of the phone?
I know, but what's the purpose? Why it has no validation restriction?
Okay, but we remove get. How can you can read the value?
So the programmer should write the method.
Yes, you have to write the method. Otherwise, the user is not able to read. Okay, if you want just to restrict the user to modify and not to read the value, you can just skip to make a get method. So in this case, I can change, but I cannot read. If you want to only read and not change, you make a get method and not set. If you want to have access at both, you give a set method and a get method. Okay, now I want to give an access for both. So I will keep both. Yes, at the end?
The user doesn't have access to the class.
Yeah.
But he has access to the code.
No. The user has access to the class, but he doesn't have access to the attribute. Okay?
But for example, me, can I have access to, for example, classes made by Java?
Yes. String, for example.
Is it code?
Yes. Math is a class made by Java. You can have access to the code, yes. It's open source.
I saw some programmers that define scanner as private.
Mm-hmm.
Is that something
special? That define what?
Scanner as private.
Scanner as
private.
Scanner?
Yeah.
Why?
I don't know.
No, scanner is not our context. Scanner is to read an input stream.
Yes, is it private?
Yeah, you can define a scanner in the class as a private because you want just to read inside the class. You don't want to put it outside. It's possible. Okay. Okay, that's fine. So now I have to do the same in order to be able to solve these errors. I have to write get and set methods for every and single attribute. So I'm going now to write public string. So get first name. And then I will make return first name. So this will allow me to read the first name from outside. Okay, public string, get last name. And here return last name. Address is lowercase. And also I can get the GPA, public double, get GPA. And what I should return? So return GPA. So now I made all the get methods for the attributes. I must do the same, but for the set methods. So public, what I should return for set first name?
String.
No?
Void.
Void, yeah. Okay. Okay. Okay, I don't have a string. I have set first name. And what I should put here between parentheses? String fn. And the, here what I will do, okay, first name equal fn. So for the first name, I don't have any restriction, so I can, if you want to have personal restriction, you can just put an if condition. But now I'm going to skip the if condition here for the first name and also the last name. For the last name, what do we return?
Void.
Set last name, okay. And here we have a string ln, and here we have last name equal to ln. Now for the GPA. Set GPA. Okay, so the parameter here is what? Double. I'm going to make a GPA in capital letter here. Yes, and then?
Should be more than 3.
What is the constraint on the GPA?
Bigger than 0.
Bigger than 0? Yeah, and now so if the GPA of parameter is greater than 0.0, okay, and what? And GPA is less than 4.0 or equal, okay, it can also be equal to 0, I think, events, then so in this case, the GPA lowercase is equal to GPA uppercase. Okay, it's here equal here. Okay, else I can make through new legal argument exception, or just I'm going to make wrong GPA values. But usually it's better to write an exception. Okay. So now I will enforce GPA to be between 0 and 4. And finally, for public void, set address, string ADR, okay, address is equal to AADR. Now I have all the set and get methods, so how can I fix this? What I should do? Student 1 dot? I would like to change. Set. Set first name. Now I would like to change it. Okay? So same thing here. I would like to change the last name. What I should do?
Student 1
dot? Set last name, okay, I'm going to write here. Okay, now I don't have, do I have any error? Yeah, so what I should write here to fix this? Because I want to read, so I'm going to use get first name. Okay, if I want to have the address or the GPA, for example, GPA. Student 1 dot get GPA. You see now, I have hidden all the information, all the attributes, but I provided him access through my interfaces that I defined, get methods to read and set method to write. Okay. So, this concept is known as the concept of data hiding, which is also known as encapsulation. So this is one of the important concepts in object-oriented programming. There are several concepts like inheritance, polymorphism, but the first concept now you have learned about in object-oriented programming is data hiding, which is also equal to encapsulation. So data hiding, I think it's clear why we call it data hiding. Because we hide the data inside the class, so it's not visible from the outside. I think it's clear. Now, why we call it encapsulation? What does it mean, encapsulation? Yeah, it's like we put it into a box. So it's encapsulated into the class. That's why it's hidden. So both, okay, they have the same meaning. So data hiding and encapsulation. This is done using the private access specifier for the attributes. Okay. Fine. Now, what's the problem? Now, look, if I'm going to want to put some wrong values here, and some wrong values here for the phone number. Okay? Yeah, why this happened? Because these values were put in the constructor. And in the constructor, we didn't call the set methods. So this is unsafe. So it's better that instead of writing this, we can do set first name fn. Okay, set last name ln. Set phone, and here it's going to impose the constraint, okay, ph, and we are going to see whether it will work. And set gpa, what is it? It's gpa, and set address. Now, if I execute the same program, I don't have any compilation error, but if I execute the same program, illegal argument exception. Now it's detected. Because here I put a bad... Look, this is now 10 digits. I will put 11 digits. It will not go through. So it's only when I put the correct values for both that the program will execute fine. You see now why you use a set method, and it's better to call it inside the constructor so that from the creation of the object, from the initialization, you enforce the values that you would like to enforce.
In your tutorial, you moved the private.
Which private? I didn't move the private. Private is here defined. All of these are defined as private. Okay? And here in the constructor, we set all the values to this. Voila. Okay. One more thing, let me go to set first name. So instead of writing fn here, imagine that I wrote first name as a parameter name, and here I will write first name so that this makes sense. Does it make sense? Let's try, no problem. Let's run. I'm going to run my program. Is it set the first name? Why? Because here, simply, but here both of them, both of them, they are in black. So both of them are considered as parameters. So this is because local variable, they overwrite global variable when they have the same name. Okay? الأقرب هو اللي يعتبره compile. Now there is a conflict. Maybe the attribute name or parameter name. So since they are working locally at the method, so it will override whatever shame CS101. Okay? So now I would like to tell the compiler that this must be the attribute and this must be the parameter. How can I do it? So one of the things is to change the name. Yeah. Another thing is that we need to have a reference to the attribute, and there is a special keyword in Java that is called this. So this, it makes a pointer to the same object. So this is the object, and then when I make dot, I will have access to its first name. Look now, it changed the color to green. So the compiler knows now that the first operand here is the attribute, and the second operand here is the parameter. Because first name is preceded by the keyword this that refers to the object. So I'm explicit to the compiler saying that I would like that you consider the first operand as the attribute. So this is also possible even when there is no conflict. By default, when you don't put this, it's already there implicitly. So this is called implicitly for the attributes when there is no conflict. Okay, so now even if I make here last name, and here last name, there is not going to be a confusion. Now if I put GPA here, I'm going to have the same issue. So how to solve? Where? Here? 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 The left. Okay, so this solves the confusion for the compiler and knows what is the attribute and what the parameter is. Is this clear? Not really, but sometimes it may happen, and if it happens, you know how to solve. Okay? Is this clear? Okay, so these are some important features about object-oriented programming, and the most important concept today is encapsulation and data hiding. That is, declaring the attributes as private and provide them get and set methods for the client programs to use them. Okay, that's all for today. Naam.